This conference
This
will now be
conference will
recorded.
Now be recorded.
Okay. So I think last session was started understanding about the different types of statements which we can write in a program. So first we are understanding about the memory statements. So why we need to allocate the memory. So to deal with the memory statement, we should know about the data types. So these are the list of data types available. By using this data type, we can allocate the memory. Okay, technically all these are the tokens. In a specific way, if you want to call the tokens which are provided by system and which we cannot change the meaning. Okay, string, integer, double, decimal. So all those are the keywords. Even after allocating the memory, if you don't store any value, by default system holds null. That is also a keyword, right? Identifier means, as a developer, for our identification purpose, we give some names, right? The name for memory, whatever we are allocating, whatever we are giving, that we call as identifier, our data member, our variable. On day to day, we call as variable, okay? So just understand. And also we are understanding about the indentation. So variable, okay, so we have to, as a experienced developer, we have to follow some of the standards. Okay, it's, we have to follow the camel case. Okay, so if you see like this, and also the variable name should be meaningful. So even though you don't follow, still our program will work. Okay, but the things what we need to follow for sure, the variable names. So what are the names we can give for a variable? Okay, so for example, I'm defining one integer value, data type integer. I'm saying like this, which is not valid, right? So this is invalid. If you want to practically check whether it is a valid syntax or not a valid syntax. So once we log into the Salesforce, so some of you, if you don't know, if you don't have the account, you need to go to this website, developer.salesforce.com. So click on sign up and just fill the form, write your first name, last name, a valid email address. So all those things, once you fill the form, you will get one email. And by checking your email, you need to set the password and the security question. So then you can log in. Okay, once you log in, it will be like this. Okay, so as a developer, to play with the code, you need to click on this gear icon. Once we click on that one, you see one option called developer console. Open the developer console. Okay, click on developer console and open the developer console. So this is the developer console. Okay, so now here click on debug. Okay, click on open execute anonymous window. So if you click on this one here, as a developer, we can write some Apex code and execute and see how it is working. Okay, so just for testing as a developer to play with the code. Okay, so here, so whatever I'm saying, right, integer, so if you try to define, you see error, right? Integer variable can have a number, but it should not start with a number. That's the rule. If you give like this, and if you try to execute, you see error, unexpected token, right? So at the time of saving the program itself, we see the error, syntax error, right? So this is invalid. So which is valid? If you keep that number somewhere later, at least after one of the character, now this is valid. If you execute, you don't see any error, right? That means the syntax is correct. Okay, that's the meaning. Okay, So just play here. That's what I suggest. Okay. So this is valid. Okay. So the point is here. The point is variables can have number, but it should not start with the number. So that is the rule. Okay. So one more point. Variables should not have the special character except underscore. Variables should not have special characters except underscore, but it should not start with underscore. So that is the rule. Okay. So if you want to check integer underscore like this is invalid, right? And also in the code, right? Slash slash means comment. Okay. So if you give slash slash and after that whatever you want, if you type, system won't check for the syntax. That is, as a developer, to understand something we give. Okay. So I'm saying that this is invalid, right? So let's see, say execute, and if you see invalid character identified, so it should not start like this. But after first character, anywhere if you keep, this is valid, right? Execute and this is valid. Okay, so for sure we have to follow some of the naming names, how we need to name the variable. Okay, and one of the next thing, variable name should not be the keyword. Variable name should not be the keyword, right? Let's say if I say integer null, null is a keyword. We should not use that one, right? This should be invalid. Okay, if you try to execute, see unexpected token null. So we should not give like this. Okay. But after this, if I append something, so really that is not a keyword, right? Because I added something, now it will accept. Okay. Just understand about that. Okay, the next point, variable should not have any spaces. Okay, if you give like this, it is invalid, right? Variable should not have space. Okay, this is invalid. But if you don't give space, it will accept, right? So this will be valid. This is just a comment. Okay, so execute and this is valid, right? So like that, just to understand these things. Okay, so with this, now we know how we can define a memory statement, right? Before we switch to the next topic, understanding about the arithmetic and logical operators. So far, I'm saying that we have these data types, blob, boolean, all these are the data types, right? So whatever the data types, now we are seeing these things we call as primitive data types. Okay. Again, we have two different types of data types. Primitive data types. Primitive data types means whatever the value present in the, right? So let's say we say call by value. Okay, the meaning of this primitive data type, if you allocate the memory, right? Let's say here I am allocating the memory, right? So whatever the memory it allocates directly into that memory, whatever the value we assign, it will store. The value whatever we are assigning will store directly in the memory whatever system allocate. That is called by value, right? Directly. So we define a memory, right? Directly we are saying equal to and assigning the value, right? Something like this, right? So this we call as call by value, right? Call by value means directly after allocating the memory, we can assign the values directly, okay? So we also have the non-primitive data types, okay? So let's understand about that. Here I am placing say non-primitive data types. Here we say call by reference, okay? So the thing is, whatever the variable we define, it won't hold the value directly. The variable whatever we define can hold only the memory address. The data will be somewhere. Where is the data? That address it will store. So that's why we call as call by reference. So what are the non-primitive data types? So let's understand. Okay, the first thing, all the standard objects. Okay, in Salesforce, we have many standard objects, right? We have many standard applications. We have many standard objects. Objects are the database tables, right? So we have accounts, we have contacts, we have opportunities, we have cases. There are many standard objects. All the standard objects we can consider as non-primitive data type. Okay, so for example, I'm saying contact is one of the standard object, right? So this is one of the non-primitive data type. Okay, if you want to define the variable for this and the store. So technically this contact is nothing but a database table. It is a table, right? So let's say in the table, assume that the contact is a table, right? So basically it is a table. In the table, if you want to add one row, if you want to add one row in the table, we create one variable for contact. This is like we are planning to store one row in the contact table, right? So maybe let me show you. Okay, so here, so isn't that we have so first name, last name of a person, let's say these are some of the records, right? This is a contact table. In this contact table, there are two rows. I want to insert one more row. If you want to insert one more row, we create one instance for that contact table. Okay, so contact and con. Now here, we cannot directly assign the value, right? Because this is not, this is a row. This row is having many cells like this, like this, like this, right? It's not that directly everything we can assign. Each row will be having one, two, maybe if you have one more column, all these cells we need to populate. So directly assigning those values is not possible. Okay, so first what we do, we create one empty row. Okay, so for that we just say equal to, by using new operator we are going to store one empty row. This is one empty row. Okay, so now when you look into this contract, this it cannot have the data directly. Okay, it will be having the location where the record is present. Let's say this record is present in fourth row, right? In the Excel sheet it is there in the fourth row, that location it hold, right? Fourth row in the contact table, so that location only it hold, right? It cannot hold the value directly. That location it holds, it cannot hold value directly, right? So by using this location, right? So now I want to populate value present in this first name, right? Right, so in the column A, right? So the location for that is right in the contact. When I say first name, right? So whatever the first name is equal to. Now if you want to populate this one, right, we can populate. Okay, so let's say I'm giving some name, like this. So we have to queue like this. This value directly we cannot assign here. Okay, so all non-primitive data types needs memory allocated by using new operator. Okay, this is like empty memory. This returns the reference, means the location where this memory is allocated. Using that reference we identify the corresponding right attributes and we populate that information. Okay, so that's the non-primitive data type. That's why we say call by reference. Directly we cannot assign, right? If it is a number, directly I can assign value, but for non-primitive directly we cannot assign the value. We have to allocate the memory by using new operator, and the variable will hold the location where the memory allocated. Okay, so whenever we say con, it will point to the location where the memory is allocated by the system. Okay, so you can access the value present in that, or you can assign the value like that. Okay, for now maybe 100% if you are not able to understand, it is fine. Okay, slowly we'll understand. So one of the next type, we have custom objects also, right? Custom objects means the objects which are not provided by Salesforce, which we create as per the client requirement. Those are the custom objects. In our project already we created some custom objects called course, applicant, course application, all those things, right? So let's say course underscore underscore C is one of the custom object. Okay, so this also is one of the non-primitive data type, right? So let's say if you want to create one course in the course table, if you want to create one row, what do? We give some name. First we need to allocate the empty row. This is like empty row, right? This returns, it creates the memory to store one row and returns the location where this row is allocated. Right now this holds the location where this row was generated. Okay, now in that row if you want to populate each and every column value, right, it's like this value, this value, this value, this value. If you want to populate by using this reference, the location, right, we give the name, right? So for now we need to populate this, right? Let's say it is D4. For now I'm just giving like this, and you can assign whatever the value you want. It's like that. Okay, this is just an example. Okay, actually how we do, I'll explain. Okay, so this is about the non-primitive data type. So, and also we have one more type called S object. Okay, so S object is generic to hold either standard object or custom object information. Okay, so if you see, when I say contact, right, when I define the contact, we can only store the contact row, right? So I cannot say, if I define contact and storing some other object information like this is not possible, right? This memory is for some other table, not for contact. Like this, it is not possible. So this is wrong, right? In some situations, we don't know on which table we are going to maybe save the record. Okay, so if you want to maintain the information in a generic way, we use S object. So when you say S object, right? So let's say S object, which information we can store? We can store any information, whatever you want, right? So let's say I'm creating one more object, new. I can also store contact or course underscore underscore C, any information. Okay, this is to represent the table information, right? Object information in a generic way. Okay, and also the point is it can hold only either the standard object or custom object information. If you say I want to store a number, it is not possible, right? So people in general compare with object. If you see, if you go back and see, we have object, right? One of the primitive data type. Okay, so I told that it is generic to hold any type of data. S object, I'm saying it is generic to hold only either standard object or custom object. Object is more generic when compared to S object. S object can only hold either the standard object or the custom object information. Just understand that point. Okay. And also we have one more category called FX class. Okay, still we did not create. Going forward, we are going to create. We can also consider FX class as a non-primitive data types. Okay, for now, just understand we have non-primitive data types. Okay, going forward, we understand more about this. Okay, so that's it for these data types. Okay, so any questions? So far, any questions, anyone? Okay, so the next thing what we need to understand about the arithmetic and logical operators. Okay, so all these are the basics. Maybe some of you might already know, but some of you, if you are very new to technology, these will be useful. Okay, the first one what I want to explain about the assignment operator. Okay, assignment operator. Okay, the purpose of the assignment operator is the right hand side value it will assign to left side, right? It's like mathematics, right? Mathematics, how we follow in the same way. Always the right hand side value will be assigned to the left hand side value. So for example, I'm giving like this integer number 1 is equal to 100. Number 2, I'm not giving anything. Now I'm saying number 2 is equal to number 1. The meaning of this one is the value present in the number 1, which is 100, that will be assigned to number 2. So that's what will happen. Okay, so just understand, that is the basic thing. The next thing, arithmetic operators. So in this, arithmetic means we use maybe addition, subtraction, multiplication. For multiplication, we use star. Okay. Division, we use the slash. So many more operators are there. And also, when we deal here, we have again different classifications. We have unary operators. We have binary operators. We have ternary operators. Okay. So unary operator means one value, one operator at a time. That is unary operator. For example, I. Okay, so in general, in most of the programs, you see I plus plus, right? I minus minus, like that. Okay, so how exactly it works? Let's say we have integer I is one of the variable. The default value is zero, right? When I say I plus plus, what is the meaning of this one? The meaning of that one is I is equal to I plus 1. I is equal to I plus 1. That's the meaning of this operator. Okay, now if you see here, this is one variable and the plus plus is incrementing the value by 1. Right? Internally, the meaning of this I plus plus is I equal to I plus 1. In the short form, we use like this. Okay, this we call as unary operator, right? So you can also say I minus minus, or the variable name can be anything, right? If you say count or number, num minus minus 1, num plus plus, like that we use. Okay, so just understand this one. So let me show you with some example, right? So if you go back here, go to the developer console and right. So make sure to click on debug and open execute anonymous window. This is the one, right? So here we can type the code and see how exactly we are dealing. So I'm saying integer, right? It's not that always we need to use I. The variable name can be anything, whatever you feel, right? Let's say I'm saying count, right? So by default, zero. Okay, so we have count plus plus. So what is the meaning? It is incrementing the count value by 1. Now after that statement, the count will be 1. Okay, so when you deal with this code, if you want to print as a developer, if you want to understand what are the values present in the variable, right? If you want to print this information in the log, in general, whenever we execute, if you see in the background, system generates a log for each and every statement, how much memory is allocated, how it is working, system generates a log. In that log, if you want to print some message and see as a developer how it is working, okay, we use system.debug. Okay, for now, just understand, if you want to print something in the log as a developer to understand, we use system.debug. Okay. So here, I'm just referring that count. Now I am expecting this value as 1, right? Because after this statement, it is incrementing the 0 by 1. Now, if you print it, the value of this one should be 1, right? So now execute. And also, if you want to automatically open the log after executing, you need to click on this checkbox so that it will execute and open the log whatever system generates automatically. Okay, so check that and click on execute. The log is opened automatically. And if you see here how the program started, so how many bytes it allocated, all that information step by step it will hold. Okay, so for us, looking into our value is very difficult, right? So if you want to see only what we printed as a developer, you need to click on this debug only, right? If you click on this debug only, so we are seeing only this value, right? 1. This value, this is what we printed, right? So the value of the count is 1, right? It is correct. So let's say if I use this one, two times, right? So now what should be the count? 2, right? Initially the count is 0. After this statement the count will be 1, and after this statement the count will be 2, right? It will increment the existing value. So here 0, here it becomes 1. Again plus plus means again it will add one more 1, total 2. Now here you should see the count as 2. Execute and click on debug only if you see you are seeing the count as 2. So that is how this works. Okay, and also people ask, so we have this plus plus at the end of the variable, right? We can also keep before the variable and ask people, ask what is the difference. Okay, so to show that for you, so here itself I am saying count plus plus, right? And printing, right? And also for our differentiation, right, integer, here I'll say I equal to 0, system dot debug. Here I'll say plus plus I. Okay, just see what is the value it returns. Okay, and also while printing, I want to have more clarity why I am printing this in the debug to see in a meaningful way. Okay, so I'm writing a string, right? Count. So this is a string. In Apex code, whenever you want to give the string value, we have to give inside the single quote. So for this string, I want to concatenate this value, right? Again, just do like this. Okay, so this is a string and this is the variable. So if you want to concatenate, we use plus operator and concatenate. Okay, in the same way here I want to have more clarity which value I am printing, right? I'm giving space and right, and execute and see. Okay, I'm executing. So here what is the value of the count? 0, right? Value of the I is 1, right? So what will happen? This, when you use plus plus, what will happen? It will increment the value by 1. But if you directly refer this return value, it will be 0 only. In next statement, if you print that, you will see count as 1, right? Here, if you print a count value, you will see 1, right? But here, immediately, if you try to access the value present, whatever it returns, the returned value, if you want to try to access, that is 0. But after this statement, if you refer, it will be 1. Okay, so the thing is I plus plus will be counted later. Okay, so it returns the original value and the count will be, you can access later after this statement executed. But this one, it will increment and the return that incremented value immediately. That's the difference. Okay, so now again execute. So here I append name plus, execute. So click on debug only. Now if you see, right, so count 0 and the count value 1, right? So technically what I'm trying to say, so this immediately after executing this one, it returns the existing value only. It won't return the value which is incremented. But when we use plus plus, pre-increment, okay, so it immediately returns the incremented value. That's the difference. Other than that, so both are almost the same. In the same way, we have I minus minus, count minus minus we can use. Okay, So minus minus means it will decrement the value by 1. So like that. Okay. So these are some examples. So just understand. Okay. So these things we call as unary operator. The reason is one value and one operator at a time we are using. Right? That we call as unary operator. So binary operator means the big expression. For example, here I'm saying integer number 1 is equal to 100, number 2 is equal to 10, so number 3 is equal to 5, and I'm just giving this, right? I'm defining all these variables of the type integer, right? Now I'm saying result is equal to number 1 minus number 2 multiplied by number 3. So this is an example of the binary operator. Binary operator means it deals with the two values and one operator at a time. But if you see here, we have many operators and many values, right? Even though you give like this, how internally system works, system only take two values. First, it will verify this. Number 2 multiplied by number 3, right? What is the result? Let's say 10 multiplied by 5. 50, right? Now this result, it will decrement from 100, right? Now finally result is 50. So like that, even though we have the big expression, it deals with only two values and one operator at a time. That's why we call this one as binary operator. Even though we see the complex expression, internal behavior, how it works, two values and one operator. Okay, that is a binary operator. And also, now in this expression, first it will multiply this one and the subtract, or first it will subtract here and multiply. So what will happen? There is a confusion.
First multiply. Right?
Multiply and so how can you, how can you say that first it multiply? Okay, so in the language we have the operator precedence. Okay, when you use minus, plus, maybe star and maybe division, so all those things, which operator should have more preference, that will be executed first. Okay, so the thing is, you should know about the operator precedence, okay, to exactly know so which will execute first. Okay, for now what I am doing, I am printing this result and see what is the value. Okay, based on that we exactly know. Otherwise we have to see the documentation. System gives more preference for star or maybe minus, right? So if you see, you are saying 50, right? So that means this is executing first, and after that it is subtracting, and the final result is 50. But my requirement is I want to first to subtract and after that multiply. That's the requirement. Okay, if you want like that, we enclose that in the bracket. If you do like this, system evaluate this one separately. Okay, now 100 minus 10, 90. 90 multiplied by 5. Whatever the result is there, that it gives, right? So we can, by using these brackets, even though we don't know about the operator precedence, most of the times by using these brackets, we control. So which it should execute separately. Okay, so now 90 multiplied by 5, right? I think 450, right? You are saying 450, right? So it is working fine. This is an example of the binary operator. Okay, binary operator. So if you have any questions, you can ask. Okay, the basics are most important. Okay, so if you are not able to understand, let me know. The next one, ternary operator. Okay, so ternary operator, so what is the purpose of this one? So here we give some condition. Let me give one example here. So let's say here result only. What I want to check, number 1 and number 2, right? Whichever is having the big value, I want to assign that value to result. Okay, so I'm checking a condition. Okay, so number one. Okay, so greater than. We use the greater than operator. I mean, this is one of the relational operator. Okay, for comparison purpose. Okay, I'm just checking is the number one is greater than number two. Question mark. Okay, this is the condition. Okay, question mark. If this condition is satisfied, after question mark, whatever I give, system will take that. Right, I am saying number one. Colon. If this condition is false, if this condition is true, it executes this part. If this condition is false, it is going to execute whatever I am going to give here. Okay, this is one of the example of the ternary operator. We check for a condition. If the condition is satisfied, which value or which expression you want, that it will take. If that is not satisfied, after colon, whatever is there, it executes. Okay. Now, if you see three expressions and two operators, right? So this is the ternary operator. We are dealing with the three values, three expressions. So this is a condition. The condition is satisfied. This one, not satisfied. This one. Okay. This is an example of the ternary operator. Now, what should be the value of the result? Right? 100 greater than 10. Yes. That means it is returning number one, 100. Right? Now the result is 100. If you execute, click on debug only, and if you see the result is 100, right? So let's say here, so I'm giving this value as 2000. Now what will be the result? 100 greater than 2000? No. So it takes this. What is the value of the number 2? 2000, right? So the value of the result will be 2000. Execute. Right? So again, go back and copy, and I'm just keeping here for your reference. Okay, so this is about the ternary operator. Okay, so the next thing, so what I want to explain, arithmetic assignment operator. Okay, let's see how it works. Arithmetic assignment operator. Okay, so one of the example, so let's say here I want to add number one and number two, and I want to see after adding the value of the number one. Okay, so now what I'm going to do, in general, if you want to add two variables values, number one is equal to number one plus number two, right? So that means 100 plus 2000, 2100, right? We know about this. Instead of writing like this, okay, we can also write like this, number one plus equal to number two. The meaning of this expression is number one is equal to number one plus number two. So this is the short form, right? So maybe if you are comfortable with this, you can use this, right? But if other developers use like this, at least that time we need to understand why they are using like that. Okay, so if you see, this is a combination of arithmetic operator and assignment operator. Right, in place of plus, you can also use a star slash. Star means multiplication. Right. So now, if you see the result of this one should be 2100, right? You see 2100 reversing, right? So this is the arithmetic ascent. Instead of plus, we can also use star. Star means it will multiply, right? So let's say I'm using star, 2000 multiplied by 100, right? It will be like 2 lakhs, right? Execute. You see, it is 2 lakhs, right? So, like that. Okay, just understand. Just a copy and pasting here for our reference. Okay, in place of plus operator, you can use minus, star, maybe slash for division, all those things. Okay, the next one is about the. Yeah.
The place of plus is equal to we use. If we use a equal to plus, what will happen?
It won't support. Like equal to plus is, let's see, still it is working. Let's see what is the value. Click on debug only. Now 2000, right?
Yeah.
It's not really adding, right? So it is ignoring. So number one, so maybe, right, still the number one value is this one. Let's check the number two value. Okay, since it is accepted, so I want to cross check what is the value of the number two, right? So let's execute and see. Okay, now this number two, that becomes 2000. Number one became, so basically the value of the number one should be 100, right? So it is ignoring and it is taking as SN. So when you use number one equal to plus, so what it is taking, it is directly understanding that it should assign the value. Okay, so that's what is happen. Okay, so the next thing, relational operator. Okay, relational operator. Okay, so we have different relational operators. So we have equal. Equal means comparison. Both values are same or not. Okay, we have less than equal to, greater than equal to. We also have not equal to. Not equal to can be represented in two ways. So like this, not equal to and also not equal to, in two ways we can represent. Okay, so just understand about this. And now why we use these relational operators, we do the comparison and the relational operators returns either true or false, right? So always the result of the relational operator will be either true or false. If for example, so when I say number one is equal to number two, right? The meaning is I am not saying that I am assigning number two value to number one. Assignment is only single equal. Double equal means comparison. It compare both values are same or not. If the both values are same, it returns true. If both values are not same, it returns false. Now in the log, you see the result of this one as false because both are not same. 100 is equal to 2000. No. The value will be, the result will be false, right? So in the same way, equal, and maybe if you want to use some other condition, I'm just checking number 2 is greater than number 1. Right here, number 2 is 2000 is greater than 100. Number 1 is 100. Yes, it returns true. Right? So we know that this one should be false. And this is just a comment. Right? So this one should be true. So after executing in the log, first we have to see false. Later we need to see true. So let's see. Execute. And if you see false and true, so that means however we are thinking, it is working, right? So this is an example of the relational operator. Okay, so we use greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, all those things we can use as per the requirement. Okay, so just understand. Now some situations, I want to compare these two conditions. I don't want like only one condition. Number 1 is equal to number 2, or number 2 is greater than number 1. If any one of the conditions satisfied, the final result should be true. Right? If you want or, or if you want and between multiple conditions, so that we call as logical operators. Okay, we have logical operators. We have and, or, not. All these are the logical operators. But in FX programming, directly we cannot use and. Right? Instead of and, we use this symbol. And, and. Also, for or, so we use two pipe symbols. Okay? For not, we use exclamatory symbol. Okay? So just understand. So these are the different operators, okay, and or not. So these things. So now let me take one example here. You want to keep these two conditions. I want to combine both. Any one of the conditions should be true. I mean, if any one of the condition is true, the final result should be true. So here we know that 100 is equal to 2000, no, false. Or number 2, 2000 greater than 100. Yes, it is true. False or true. So when you deal with or, any one of the condition is true, that will be the final result. Now this will be true. For the same thing, if you use and, right, what will happen? And means both conditions should be satisfied. For the same thing, if I use and, so what will happen? The result of that one should be false. Right? So it's like this. Here, first condition, number 1 is equal to number 2. We know that that is false. Right? Or number 2, 2000 greater than 100, yes, true. The result will be in the same way here. When you use and expect all conditions should be satisfied, right? That's why the value of this one should be false. Execute and see. True and false, whatever we are expecting, we are getting. And also maybe to understand about all different combinations, right? So I'll be adding a few more things. First, let's say I'm saying not equal to, right? So 100 not equal to 2000, yes, true, right? And maybe first I want to play with all end conditions. Okay, and so I know number 1 not equal to number 2, true, and number 2, 2000 greater than 100, true. The final result will be true. So maybe when you have, just I'm giving like this. This is 2. And this one, I want to make it false, right? So I'll say less. I know that number 2, 2000. Right, so number 2, 2000 is less than number 1. Yeah. This one also I want to make it false, right? Number 2 is less than number 1. Yeah, correct. No, right? Number 2, it's false. I want that one. Okay, false. Okay, so here we have 10. And also, so this should be false, false. Okay, so now true, false, true. So this one I want as false. So again, I'm saying, yeah, just I'm trying to get all the combinations. Okay, if both are true, the final result will be true when you deal with the end condition. If any one of the condition, left side or right side, if any one of the condition is false, the final result should be false. Right? Both are false. So the final result should be false. Okay. So just possible combinations. Now when you execute, we have to see, right? True, true. Sorry. So false. Because both are true, then only it becomes true. Right? In rest of the situations, if any false is there, final result will be false. So when you execute, see, right, true, false, false, false. It's working, right? So maybe for us to understand, we are printing this one for end. For end, how the result is. This is what we are printing now. Now, what I'll do. So again, go back. Yeah, so here, again, copy this. Now I want to show you with OR condition, right? OR. Keep OR for all these things. OR means if any one of the condition is true, the final result will be true, right? So now here it should be OR. So any one of the condition is true, the final result will be true, right? So now execute and see. And also maybe not, right? Not is reverse. Whatever existing thing is there, for that the reverse is not. Maybe to show you what I'll do. So not of true is false, right? Not means it will make that result as reverse. Okay, so it should become false, right? So let's execute and see. Now we see for end, right? Only both are satisfied, that time it is true. Remaining everything false. For R, if any one of the condition is true, it is true. If both are false, then only it is false. And this is reverse. We gave true, but here it is printing as false because we are using not, right? So these are some of the things we should know about the logical operators. Okay. So these are the things, just an example. Tomorrow we deal with the other types, right? The conditional, by using this logical operators and all these things, how we really deal. So those things we'll discuss. Okay, this I suppose it to keep under this one. Tomorrow we see by using these relational operators and logical operators how we deal with the conditional statements. Okay, we have mainly if conditions, right? So about that we discuss tomorrow. Okay. So before ending today, any questions, anyone? Someone is pinging in the chat. So I did not understand what is that. Yeah, anyway, any questions before ending? Okay, sure. Anyway.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. We'll continue tomorrow. Thank you.